Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Good evening, friends. Welcome back to our CE401 Water Resources Engineering class. We are looking at the Water Resources Engineering part. Right? We have seen so far dam engineering, types of dams, forces acting on the dam, then reservoir engineering, what is the reservoir, what is the purpose, what are all the investigations you need to carry out for dam and reservoir engineering, okay, how to find the capacity of this reservoir, that means height of the dam, ripple diagram, sequent peak algorithm, then estimating the dead storage level using sediment load as well as silt. After seeing this reservoir engineering, we store water for several purposes, out of which irrigation release is the major use. So 80 to 85% of water stored in dams are used for irrigation or irrigation purposes. So we need to utilize that water optimally. How to utilize the water optimally? You need to supply only the required quantity of water. So then you need to estimate how much water is required by the crops at field. Normally that we estimate using evapotranspiration. Then multiplied with the crop coefficient, you will get the depth of water at the root zone. Then if I want to supply that much, how much I need to supply at canal head or at from the reservoir level, because there is lot of losses. The major losses are conveyance loss and then application losses. Conveyance losses means the water seepage through the canal when it is moving from the reservoir to the field. We can reduce that by lining or by using piped irrigation system. Then application efficiency, that means application. How we apply the water in the field, that also causes the efficiency. If you are using conventional flooding method, a lot of losses will be there. If you use sprinkler and drip irrigation, then your losses will be less. So agricultural practice or irrigation methods also governs the irrigation efficiency. So in irrigation engineering, we have seen three broad topics. One is crop water requirement. The second one is irrigation scheduling. What frequency I need to irrigate water to the crops. Then the third one is irrigation efficiencies. How efficient is my water? That means what is the efficiency of water used for agricultural purposes. That is that chapter. Then after that, the another important purpose of water is to produce hydroelectric power. Right? There we have seen what is a dam. What is hydropower plant, components of hydroelectric power plant, types of hydroelectric power plants depending upon its hydraulics, capacity, turbine, head available for energy production, right? Then after this we have seen different types of turbines and then how to select a turbine based upon the head, specific speed and discharge. So these are all things we have seen in hydropower engineering. In first class, we had said that dams are water storage structure constructed to reduce the temporal water availability problem. If I store the water when water is available excess, then the water is available at that location throughout the planning period. But there may be other location where it's not possible to construct the dams and reservoirs. Then how to reduce that spatial water availability problem? You construct a network of canals, right? And transport the water from reservoir to the field. And that engineering is called as canal irrigation engineering, right? Or irrigation canal design engineering. There are different types of canals, like canal passing through alluvial soil, canal passing through non-alluvial soil, ridge canals, contour canals, all these things we have seen in canal headwork, canal irrigation engineering. Then when I want to develop or when I want to divert a water from the river to the canal, then there should be some obstruction in the river so that the water level will rise if the canal is not from the reservoir. Such works like pickup air, barrages, they are called as river head works. In this river head works, the major difference between design of weirs and barrages and dams are proposed to construct on a solid rock foundation. Whereas this river head works like weirs, barrages, we don't have option. We need to construct that weir and barrages on a sandy bed. If I want to construct it on a sandy bed, how to design it? So Blipp's creep theory and Kosala's theory are useful in designing this canal river head works. Once I construct a weir or barrage, water level rises in the river. Then I need to divert that water to the canal. When I am diverting it to the canal, there should be some structure to control the flow. And such structures are called as canal head works. So we are going to see about both river regulators and canal regulators. That means it regulates the flow of water. But I titled it as canal head regulators. Right? So you can see this. This is a dam where water goes through the canal. So it's a direct. But when the canal is taking up from the river at lower level, then you need to increase the water level in the river and divert the water to the canal. And such work is called as diversion work. So canal system starts with that head work, which can be diversion work located at the head of the canal system to divert water from source to the canal. Storage work, reservoirs constructed to meet the fluctuating demand. Right. So the major objectives of head works is to direct water from river into canal. So it is an obstruction across the river to serve the purpose of rise the water level locally. So the storage will be very minimal so that water flows into the canal by gravity. Excessive cutting of canal will be reduced. Otherwise, you need to construct the size of the canal up to the bed level of the river. And it reduces the fluctuations in the water level. Silt gets dropped before it enters into the canal system. Thus, this river head regulators and canal head regulators are constructed at the river reach as well as canal entrance to control the water supply, to prevent the flooding entering into the canal, so that only predetermined discharge will enter into the canal. So this is an example of, in this photograph you can see this small structure. This is a river intake structure and this is a canal head regulator. The river is flowing here, which is not in the picture. Water comes there by gravity, so they can close or open the gate so that water moves into the canal. Right? This is a canal head regulator in a mountainous region. Right, because there also you need to irrigate water, but it is very difficult to construct, but the area under irrigation will be very small. Right, and this is a canal head regulator in a plains. That means the river is on the upstream side, this is the downstream side of the canal. So the moment you open the gate, water from the river will go into this canal. So this type of sub-mountainous region headworks may be made. The advantage is construction material may be locally available. There is no need of any canal drops. Canal drop means the level difference of the canal from one location to another location will be very flat slope. So then, but the soil is very pervious because it may be in the alluvial soil or deltaic region. Then you need a proper draining of the canal either by lining or by pakka flooring. So this is a good example for a river head work. This is a ephemeral stream. That means whenever there is a rain, only water will flow in this stream. So this is the upstream side where some quantity of water is stored. The water comes here, so it is obstructed by a weir of 2 to 3 meters height. And when water stored more than this, it surpluses over the weir and goes in the river. And you can see the two canal, two outlets. This is right bank canal and this is a left bank canal. So when the water level rises here, the water can be diverted to this canal to irrigate. So this is a canal head regulator. These are weirs where the gates can be stored. So the water flows from right side to left side. Okay, so through stage of the river, this may be located in the region. The advantages are, these are all advantages, the construction materials, right? So whenever I am designing a canal head regulator or river head regulator, economics comes into the first page because it is more or less like a weir or a small dam. So material should be locally available. The river should be narrow and straight. The cost of connecting the site to the living places should be less, and the site should be very close to the cultural command area. When I am taking a canal, it may has to cross certain natural drainages. Such, that means a river joining the main river. Such crossings are called as cross drainage works. So these are all the another some more points. Good command area, then canal offtake should be as far as possible at right angles to the river. The river should have control flow without tendency of scoring or silting, and it should serve a maximum possible command area. So the major components of canal headworks are the river headworks. First one is the weir, right? And then divide wall. What is this divide wall? Divide wall is divides the sluices, because a weir cannot have the complete sluices or a opening in the part of the body to flush the sediments. Such openings are called as sluices or under sluices or covering sluices. So there is a divide wall, a wall parallel to the flow of the direction, which will divide this barrage and this scores. But when I am constructing such a structure in the river, there is a complete shut off, the hydraulic shut off from upstream to downstream. But there are several natural living beings like fish, some other living beings may have to move from downstream to upstream. Upstream to downstream, it is easier. Whenever there is a surplus or you open the gate, it goes. But how it can move from downstream to upstream? Fish is the one of the living being which can swim in the opposite direction of the water flow. Then I have to provide a structure called fish ladder, right? Where the fish can move from downstream to upstream for its growth and reproduction. Then the canal head regulator, right? These are all part of the river head regulators. Whenever I am stopping the flow in the river, huge quantity of silt get deposited. Within 2-3 years, the silt level may go up to the weir level. Then next year onwards, you cannot store any water. So every year, the end of the monsoon, you need to flush this sediment deposited through special sluices called as silt exclusion devices. Then I need to protect the banks because water gets stored, that is river training works and guide banks. These are all components of river head works. This is a good example photograph for a river head work, right? The water is simple weir. This is in other country. The water is stored through a weir. The surplus water flows through the weir. And when water level, you can see the water level difference where the arrow mark is, that is upstream side water level is higher, so water can move into the canal. This is in our India. There is a small river called as Agnya River in south, which has 42 kilometer in length, has more than 8 annexes like this. You can see this. This is the main weir. So this is the weir. Then there is a divide wall, right, which divides this weir and sluice gates. This sluice gates is to remove the silt deposited in the upstream side. But whenever water comes, then this is this wall is the guiding bank. That means river protection. You have to protect the banks, this and this. And there is another structure here. This is the canal intake. So there will be a canal, then water will go into this, and then from here it goes for the irrigation away from the river. But when the water is surplusing over the weir, it will erode all the downstream material because it is jumping at a height of 2 to 3 meters. Then you need to provide energy dissipators. This energy dissipator, sometimes it is in the form of plunge pools or concrete blocks. Like you see this, this is concrete blocks. These are all energy dissipators in the downstream side. Here in this case, it is a plunge pool. That means a basin where water jumps and reduces its velocity. So these types of weirs or anchors are very common in drought prone area to divert the minimum water flowing in the river for irrigation. Right? Then there are different types of weirs. One is pickup weir, escape weir, stoppage or diversion weir. Almost all dams are in India, or sorry, all weirs in India are only gravity weirs. We don't go for non-gravity weirs. But in Tamil Nadu, centuries back, the ruling kings have constructed this non-gravity weirs. Actually, they are not weirs. They don't surplus. That is an earthen bund. There will be a separate escape weir. So this escape weir and non-gravity weirs are part. In non-gravity weir, this water will not flow like arch. But in earthen dam bunds, that is called as irrigation tanks. Okay, so this is a good example for weirs. These are all masonry concrete weirs. This is earthen bund weir, and this is a concrete weir. This design only we have seen in our last class, that is design of weirs on permeable foundation. So there will be a weir and it will have a concrete floor, and then on the upstream side and downstream side you have a apron. This upstream bed and downstream bed, the apron design, then the creep length, everything should be estimated using Blipp's creep theory. And then using our standard empirical formulae, you can estimate what is the length of this concrete floor in the upstream side, length of the concrete floor in the downstream side, length of upstream apron on the upstream side, length of apron on downstream side. So these are all small, small design, but it boosts the irrigation in that area like anything, right? Then when there is huge quantity of water and flooding takes place frequently, like in major perennial rivers, then weirs will not be a advisable structure. There we have to go for barrage. The person who mastered design, planning, designing, construction, operation, maintenance of barrages in India is Sir Arthur Cotton, right? Some of his famous barrages are still available in India, like the Dhauleshwaram barrage in Godavari near Rajahmundry, and then the Prakasham barrage in Krishna River, and Ellis designed barrages in Kaveri. So these are all constructed just at the head reach of delta. So for example, those who are from Andhra Pradesh will understand that this Dhauleshwaram barrage bifurcates the Godavari river water into two canals, left bank canal and a right bank canal. And this has made the east and west Godavari districts very fertile. There are two purposes achieved by construction of this Dhauleshwaram barrage. First one was the flooding. Whenever river Godavari floods, it will inundate the east and west Godavari region. Now that area was reduced by regulating this water for irrigation purpose at higher levels, right? So the main difference between the weir and barrages is the storage in the weir is mainly by gates. That means you can completely remove the water stored on the upstream side to downstream side. And the first picture is Prakasam barrage, This is Dhauleshwaram barrage and this is Faraka barrage. Three famous barrages. The fourth one, we have seen it in our first slide, first class slide introduction, that is Kallani, which was constructed 2000 years back and then remodeled by Ellis throughout the cross section of Kaveri, right? So these are all the differences between weirs and barrages, right? Now this divide wall or graon, it's a long wall at the right angles to the axis of the weir, right? To separate the weir from the undersluices, undersluices through which I dispose the sediment. The wall extends upstream to a little distance beyond the beginning of the head regulators, canal head regulators. Thereby, it reduces the silt entry into the canal. Okay, so its major functions are to separate the cover sluices, to separate the pockets from covering sluices, to prevent formation of cross currents, to cut off the main portion of the river, and to concentrate the action of undersluices for silt deposit. Right. So this is weir downstream side. We are sitting on the downstream side of that small river head regulator. So this is the weir, and this is the sluices. And where we are sitting is the canal divider, divide wall. And these are all the energy dissipating blocks. So whenever there is a heavy flood coming in this river, these gates will be opened. So the silt will be flowing first through these gates, then only the surplus will weir. So these under sluices or covering sluices, the major function is preservation of clear and defined river channel approaching, covering the silt deposited in front of the canal regulator, facilitate the working of weir crest shutters. See, lowering the highest flood level by providing greater bay per meter length than the solid weir. Then fish ladder, right? I just show the example. These are all certain fish ladders in large dams, right? Because there are several dams in the world which were being eliminated because to save certain species of fish, right? I think you can study about this Solomon fish, right? That is one of the fish which moves from freshwater mountainous region to the ocean, grow there, and then traverse back to its birthplace through the river for reproduction. After reproduction, again it travels back to the ocean. So when you construct large number of dams and river head regulators, the hydraulic shutoff stops the entry of fish from downstream to upstream side during migration. So in order to facilitate the fish movement, several dams in US, they have constructed this fish ladder where there is a continuous flow of water. Hydraulic connection is made. Thus, fish ladders are provided in order to enable fish to ascend the headworks of the rivers and thus reaching the spawning grounds for propagation or to follow their migration habits. The requirement for this is the slope should not be greater than 1 in 10. So the water supply should be ample so that fish can move. That means complete well-grown adult fish can swim without any difficulty. Plenty of light should be admitted in the fishway. Top and sides of fishway should be above the ordinary water level. Okay, so that any fish which slips from this will fall into the next water level. So whenever I do a river or canal head regulator, there is huge quantity of silt deposition. Yes, it's the river. So if I send this silt to the sluice and canal, my canal will be with full of silt. So no water can go and reach the irrigation field, or my irrigation field also will receive with the sedimented water. So then what happens? We have to remove this silt. How we can remove? So in the upstream side, there is a concrete slab that is called diaphragm. So the silt which is coming in the river will enter into this bottommost portion. So it is under compressed. Then this compressed will be opened through a sluice gate. And this is provided with a diversion canal, which it will go to the side. And from there, it will go to the main river back again. Okay. So that is the purpose of silt exclusion devices. So these are all the sediment control and exclusion at headworks. The various factors which affects the sediments from river to canal, right? The alignment of the approach channel. See, the main river should be such a way that the head regulator is at 90 degree to the river flow. Otherwise, all sediments will get collected at one corner if it is skewed head regulator. Design the head regulator works in the river immediately above and below the head regulator so that the deposited sediment will not enter into the canal. It will stay only in the river. Then construct the canal head regulator also with the sediment excluders, silt ejectors or extractor, curved wings and gabion walls. These are all some of the control methods how you can reduce the silt entry into your headworks, right? And these are all the silt exclusion devices. I just gave only one. Several researchers did several methods depending upon the silt coming in the river. In general, most of the Indian canal head regulators will have these silt ejectors or silt extractors. So then canal head regulator, what is the purpose? I think I have written this. First purpose is main canal drains get water from the river through the head regulator. Main canal distributed the water to branches and miners according to water demand. So this is how we reduce the spatio-temporal water problem by constructing dams, canal head regulators and river head regulators. The alternative ways to meet varying demand is you can vary only the head regulator, but still sufficient water has to reach the canal. There are certain rivers where you have both the pickup weir and canal head regulators together, right? So this is a weir in full working condition. So this is a weir of 3 meters, 2.5 meters height. It's always in feet, 2.7 feet height. So this is upstream side where water is stored. This is the downstream side, apron. Now you can see there are three openings there. That is the canal head regulator. Where you open the sluice, water will go there. And this weir is in river head regulators. This is the same weir at dried condition. We are standing on the area where water was stored once upon. So the water stores here. This is the river flow direction. So the water flows from upstream to downstream through the silt is removed through this larger size. When water is stored, the water level will rise. You can see here water level white color up to this. Then you open this two opening is for canal head regulator. So you open this gate, water will gush into the canal. Okay, so this is the upstream apron. So these are all taken almost 15 years back in that river called Agniar, Vellar and the Ambuliar. You can Google it and see that pictures, very beautifully designed, but not now, maybe just after independence, right? So then the main functions of head regulator is to regulate or control the supply, control the silt, serve as the meter for measurement of discharge, prevent the river flooding into the canal. These are all the four major purpose of canal head regulators, right? And the other functions of cross regulators, right? Cross regulators are the river regulators to enable effective regulation of canal system as a whole, to help raise the water level. See, there is a difference between this head regulator and the cross regulator. Head regulator is also called as canal sluices. Head regulator is the river, the obstruction across the river. That is why it helps to raise the water level and feed the offtake canal. And it also helps in closing of branches in lower section of the canal to facilitate communication, since a road can be taken across them, right? To observe fluctuations in the various sections and thus prevent possibilities of breaches in the tail region, right? And the very important is the operation and maintenance, because the larger the structure, you will have less, or instead of saying larger the structure, we can say that larger the number of components, then your maintenance will be larger and larger. If number of moving components are smaller and smaller, your operation maintenance will be easier. But bears have large number of components, and every year you need to maintain it. Otherwise, suppose if this year river surpluses, then you should make ensure that before next year monsoon, the silt sediments are removed, the gates are properly greased so that you can operate the gates whenever water moves in this. And there is an IS code also, IS 7349, now 1974, which covers the maintenance and the operation of hydromechanical installations and the civil connected with barrages and weirs. So thus the operational maintenance is three types. One is hydromechanical inspection and then instrumentation. I think these are all small topics, right? In hydromechanical, the gates, falling shutter, there are certain barrages in India whose gates are operated using electric motors, right? Because there may be series like Dhauleshwaram, Krishna and Kaveri, the number of gates will be very large, maybe 30, 40. Then manually operating such gates will be very difficult. So then you have a motorized operation, switch on that button, every gates will operate by simultaneously. Otherwise, huge manpower is required for simultaneous opening of all gates, especially during floods. And then the groove where the plate moves to close the water, it has to be properly sealed. Otherwise, water will be leaking through the grooves. Then steel wire, ropes, rollers, there are several smaller components. Then civil works like aprons, right? Apron is nothing but wear, solid concrete floor, then stones pitched in a proper way so that whenever the water seepage happens, they will have some exit velocity and it will not have the eroding flow, right? That is aprons. Then sediment excluders, all these things should be inspected and then subject for maintenance, right? I think many of our small pickup weirs, they don't have instrumentation, but large barrages, they have this instrumentation also, uplift pressures, right? Like in 1968, our IS 4890 tells about what are all the instruments and measurement of suspended sediment in open channels, right? So that the maintenance can be minimized. Then there is another phenomena called as retrogression in this canal head regulators. It is a phenomena where succession reverts back to pioneer condition, such as water or bare ground. Examples of retrogression are floodwaters, fire and volcanic eruptions. How to protect during these periods your structure, okay? So the gauges from, and since this weir stagnates the water, it will have some backwater effect. So any stream gauge should be away from this backwater. So the minimum distance they say is 1000 to 2000 meters. That means in the upstream side, within 2 kilometers, you should never have a stream gauge section, right? So these are all instrumentation and performances. As I explained in our canal regulators, whenever I am constructing a weir, there is a stagnation of water. And during the flood, there will be a further additional increase in the depth of river, and that is called as afflux, right? For example, when you are designing a bridge, you need to provide piers in the cross section of the river. So whenever you are providing the piers, it reduces the cross sectional area of flow. Whenever there is a reduction in the cross-sectional area of the flow, there will be increase in velocity because of continuity equation. Whenever there is an increase in velocity, there is a contraction to divide the water to flow between the piers. Because of this contraction, there is a head up on the river, and that is called as afflux estimation. Several empirical methods, numerical models are available to estimate this afflux. Because this afflux will be very, very useful when the river is well trained and you have an upstream living beings, right? so that the afflux water will not enter and damage the adjoining properties. Okay, then you need to provide guide banks. Right, this is about canal head regulators. Now I am constructing my canal depending upon the ground, either it may be a ridge canal or a contour canal or cross slope canal. But the canals should have certain slope for the gravity flow according to Manning's formula or Chesney's formula. Suppose if the level difference is very large, right, then I cannot construct a steep slope. If I construct a steep slope canal, the sand bed materials will get eroded. In such places, we construct a special structure in the canal called as canal faults, right? Canal faults are provided when natural slope of the country is steeper than the longitudinal slope. The design consideration is the velocity in this canal. There are certain standards which says that the gravitational flow velocity should not be more than 2 meters per second. So permissible is 1.5 to 1.2 meter per second. That is the permissible limit. So the velocity of approach should be minimum and it should be able to admit variations. The bed, bank and downstream should be safe against erosion. Then in such places, you can provide a canal fault, right? There are certain rivers which has canal faults, right? And there are Oogie's type canal fault, rapid or glacis, notches, right? Vertical drop, right? Since it was constructed in this river, Sardar, it's called Sardar River. Okay, there are various types. This is an example of Oogie's canal fault. Then escape. Why we need to escape? Always civil engineer, especially water resources engineer, construct all hydraulic structure for extreme conditions. That means for drought and flood. Suppose if there is a canal taking water continuously, suddenly all the users have closed their entry. Then what happens to the water which is in the canal? It starts building up. When it starts building up, if the outlet is not there, if it is a pipe, it bursts. In canal, what happens? The water level rises and it causes flood in the adjoining properties. So then in that cases, you need to provide a separate canal which connects from the main canal at higher level to the river so that the excess water will go back to the river. Sometimes I release very small quantity, suddenly there is a rainfall and that runoff also may join with the canal. Then that water should also be safely disposed into the river. Such designs are called as canal escape. Right? I think this we no need to see this. These are all different types of escapes. Surplus escape, that is extra water enters from the canal to the river, that is surplus. Covering escape, sometimes the canal at the tail end or middle reach might have carried a huge quantity of silt and get deposited. Then you flush that sediment and silt through this covering escape. Sometimes at the canal head regulator itself, you can have a covering escape. Tail escape is at the end of the canal. What happens? Right? Then I need to divert that unused water at the end of the canal back into the river. That is called as tail escape. So this is a tail cluster. It's one tail cluster in the Punjab. That means this is the main canal, right? So this is group of farmers. This larger size is the canal and it is ending there, that canal. After that, there is no canal. Then what happens? 2-3 distributaries from the main canal are constructed so that the water will go to the field. One of the canal will act as the escape and it will go unconnected with the river. That is called as escape and this is tail cluster. Most of the time our tail end farmers, they don't receive the water mainly because of sediments in the middle reaches. So you need to keep this canal network free from the sediment, bushes, growth of plants, everything. Then only the water can reach up to the tail end. Tail end means the last portion of the canal, right? As I said, when the canal is moving from the canal head regulator to the farmers, in the certain location, it may have to cross a natural drain which is coming and join. Then how to construct that, like a bus and rail crosses, right? So when one transport is happening, another should be stopped. That we call it as level crossing. And here, when a canal and a natural drain crosses each other, that structures are called as cross drainage work. Like this, you see here, this is in Rome, famous aqueduct. This is a natural drain which is moving in the lower level, and this is at higher level which takes the irrigation canal. Okay, so this is the necessity of cross drainage work. When a canal intercepts natural stream in its passage, then I need to construct a cross drainage work. When canal alignment on the watershed crosses the number of drainages, then also we have to go for cross drainage. When the canals are aligned away from watershed, this is a very peculiar case which we normally we don't encounter. This happens only when there is a interbasin transfer, right? Then we need to construct a cross drainage work. Or when a number of canal system has to be linked, then also we need a cross drainage work. It cannot be connected just like that, right? Pipes, river open channels has to be connected properly through cross drainage work. So these are all the places where we come across this cross drainage works. There are several types of cross drainage work depending upon whether canal is moving at a higher level or natural drain is moving at higher level, right? So the cross drainage work increases the cost of the project, so we have to avoid as much as possible the cross drainages by changing the alignment or directing the drain, right? Ways of crossing the irrigation canal, right? Normally irrigation canal bed should be sufficiently above the bed of drain. Then you can do siphoning also. If it is not possible to take above the canal, you do the siphoning. We will see the different types of cross drainage. There are two types. One is simple aqueduct. Second one is siphon aqueduct. Like this, see here, this is the river drain crossing and this is a canal. Now these two has to be taken. This is the plan. You can see the canal which is moving on the up, and down is the natural drain. This is a simple aqueduct, right? Suppose if the canal and the drain are almost meeting at the same level. See, in this aqueduct, the canal is flowing at higher level than the natural drain crossing. So you take it by natural slope. But when these two are meeting at similar level, then you need to do a siphon. Okay, you see here, this in cross section I have given. In an aqueduct, the canal bed is at a higher level than the HFL of the natural drain, then simple aqueduct. But when the HFL is going to meet the canal water level, then you need to go for siphon aqueduct. That means only in this canal portion, the river will either go below the canal by siphoning. Sometimes if the canal is at very low level, the canal will be taken as a siphoning. Very recently constructed is the Krishna Chennai Metro Water. It crossed several small streams and rivers, and it is crossing Kosasthalayar. It is a siphon aqueduct. The canal moves below the river bed. Here in this case, the canal is moving above the river bed, right? Like this. This is the two types of siphon aqueducts. One is, in this case, the natural drain is at higher level and canal is at a lower level. Okay, so the canal is under siphoning action. In this, the drain is under siphoning action. Both are possible. Okay, and these are all the irrigation canal and the drain at the same level. Sometimes this is also possible. That means this siphon aqueduct and aqueduct are at two different levels. Which one is larger or smaller? Suppose if both are meeting at the same direction, then I cannot go either for siphoning or above. Then in such places, we do this level crossing. That means you combine this canal, right? Then construct a barrage in the main river or in the drainage so that the same discharge or same depth of flow flows away from the canal. Okay, so these are all the three locations of cross drainage works, right? And which one I need to select suitable cross drainage works, it depends upon the HFL of the drain, bed level of the drain, as well as bed level of the canal and HFL of the canal. So I have given some example. The types of particular location is governed by relative bed and high water level in the canal and the drainage, and also relative discharges. Okay, so I can take few minutes this one, because nowadays we are going to encounter this type of structure when we talk about interbasin transfer and intrabasin transfer. People have forgotten the signs of aqueduct and the canal faults. So if you want to see these all the structures in the canals, kindly visit certain canal network constructed, implemented and designed some 50, 60, 100 years back. A good example is Grand Anicut Canal. This Grand Anicut Canal is moving from River Kaveri at Grand Anicut near Tiruchirappalli, and it irrigates almost 3-4 districts, and it has n number of irrigation structures like canal head regulators, river head regulators, siphon, aqueduct, simple aqueduct, right, and then cross drainage, and then canal faults. And another design of canal you can see that is Indira Gandhi Canal, which moves all along the Rajasthan. Earlier it was not lined, now it is well lined, because the seepage loss in the canal was larger because it was flowing through a sandy bed. Now after lining, the problem of seepage loss is reduced and alkalinity of the soil is also reduced. Okay, this is about cross drainage works. Okay, so this is about self study. Just to see the design of canal head regulator, especially fish ladders. Those who wants to go and work in other countries where this fish is the major staple food, they bother more about this fish rather than the water, right? Then planning, investigation and designing of a weir or a barrage. Next time when you visit this Dhauleshwaram barrage, there is a museum dedicated to Sir Arthur Cotton. Please make a note to visit that museum. You can see what are all the surveying instruments he has used for reconnaissance survey, and how he did the reconnaissance survey, how he planned that weirs, how he the barrage, and how he constructed, what are all the difficulties he has faced. Not only Sir Arthur Cotton, all the engineers who are in that construction, planning, designing, construction of the dams and weirs, they write a diary called Executive Engineer Diary, and that is called as Memoirs, Executive Engineer's Memoirs. Such a famous memoirs is written and published in book is our Pennyquick book, who constructed the Periyar Dam in Kerala almost 170 years back, right, which is still a good published book by Public Works Department. Various other dam engineers might have also written this, their memoirs, that is the diary of the executive engineer. Every day he writes what are all the problems faced and how it is solved. And then design of fish ladder, right? Then design of silt extruders. Look into the picture of various sediment control. Then our IS 7720-1975. Criteria for investigation, planning and layout of barrages and weirs. And also these designs are very simple. Only thing is you need to find out what is the appropriate aqueduct depending upon the levels. Okay, so with that we are winding up our canal head regulators.